Okay, we're back to the second part of the Phoenix Tech 600 ESP build. We're going to be working on the head right now. And the T-Rex 600 ESP instructions won't help you much with this head. This head's actually a lot simpler because the original instructions were for the flybar head. Flybar head, which is a lot more complicated. So, you know, you can just watch this video, or if you want to look at the T-Rex E-Pro, that head is very similar to this one. It's almost identical, actually. So the first thing we're going to do is take this head completely apart to make sure everything's got Loctite on it and plenty of bearing grease. I'll tell you right now, this head button, there's definitely Loctite on here. So I'm guessing you're going to find, not sure if you can see it, but there is Loctite on that. That little screw. So if you find that those have definitely got Loctite on them, they're not coming out, so I am not going to mess. Well, and these ones don't. That's why it's so important to check all these. And seeing that those came out so easy, I better check this bottom one. No, it's locked in there. So you can see right there how important it is. I'm going to make sure these are clean. They look a little bit, actually, no, I can tell. Oh, there might be a little machining oil on them. So this is pretty tedious. You can fast forward it if you through it if you want. I could fast forward it, but I'm These, by the way, fit really nice. This is a nice head. It really is. So, and that's just not these scale, or these, sorry, these helicopters. Any helicopter that has got stuff pre-put together, especially the head, I always recommend taking it apart. Okay, now these, you're not gonna Loctite first, because these, when you tighten these down, there's this little slit in here, and when you tighten these washout arms down, you're actually pinching this mast, or this head onto the mast, and you've also got the Jesus bolt that goes through the hole in the top of the mast. So you've got two methods of holding this mast on. So you don't do anything with these yet. However, you do check these little guys out. This is a 1.5. That was locked in there, so I didn't have to take that out. But again, you just don't know. When in doubt, play it safe. So we'll just put a little bit on there. You'll feel after the first one comes out, if it was locked in there, how much force it took to come out or to unscrew. Again, very important, you don't put much Loctite, too much Loctite on those, because it'll weep into the bearings and seize those bearings up. That's tight. That's tight. That's tight. So we know those have Loctite on them. We know the grip arms have got Loctite. Haven't checked the balls yet, so we're going to do that. It's like a 2.5, or no, 2, sorry, 2.0. Yeah, that had it on, you can tell. And there you can tell there's the... these are kind of a pinky red Loctite. There's two thread holes here. Obviously use the outer one. It's the one that starts straight down the middle. My guess is they use the same arm for maybe a 550 head. And maybe on the 550 head, use the inner hole. I don't know, I'm just speculating that. Check this one. Yeah, it's tight, so I'm not gonna. So all that's left now are the head axle bolts. And for those, these are a big one. These are three, right? Yeah. I'm going to take these out even if they feel tight, because I don't know what the situation is on the bearing grease on the thrust bearings. And again, a lot of builders omit this step. To me, it's one of the most important things of any RC helicopter build, no matter who the manufacturer is to take the head apart and confirm that, one, there's Loctite, and two, that there is adequate grease in there. Now, to get these out, you generally need two. Allen drivers. I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to do it. No, they're tight. So we're probably going to need two. There we go. Okay, so now you'll get to see if this works or not. This can be a real bear separating these. There we go. Big guy, 3.0. So it'd be nice to have. There we go. Actually, it doesn't look like there's thread lock in here. Now, it's very important you keep all this in. I'm going to clean this right now. These are the screws that, if anything you clean, these are the ones, because you don't want these ones coming loose. Okay, so get that out. Now, be very mindful of all the spacers here. There's a brass spacer that goes on there first. Blade grip back bearing. And perhaps the most important, and yeah, not an ounce of grease in there, see? That's why this is so important that you do this. So, the other thing to take note, the line's got an in and an out on these races, and the outer race usually has, I believe it's the larger hole. I've got it in my ebook, but just take a measure. So that's 5.97. It's the diameter of the hole. Assume it's a 6 millimeter hole, and this inner race, again, there's a little spacer washer here. Do not forget to put that back in. In fact, put it back in right now. Okay, we'll measure this one. 6.2, so I was wrong. So the larger hole fits at the back. So if this was an Align helicopter, you'd have an inner laser engraved on there and an outer. So just make sure the one with the larger hole is the one towards the back. This is the front one. So now we're going to do a pack. This is where I like to use a good quality bearing grease. So you get your bearing, your thrust bearing cage, and I just like packing it all in there. Pack it in. You don't need excessive amounts of grease, but you want all those cavities filled in with grease in there. Okay, and here's where we're having a little cloth to put these down on. Even a little plastic baggie would be okay. In fact, it'd probably be better. I'm just going to grab another rag over here. And same thing, we're just going to get a little more grease. forgot which one's the inside here. There's the bigger hole, so that's the inside one. And we just put a little grease on this race. Just get that the groove in the race, get it filled in with some grease. Okay. One way to get these in, just put an Allen driver through them. Just guide it in there. Come on. Okay. If you've got a bunch of grease on the inside, that opening, just dab it out of there. The only reason is when you put it on the shaft, you don't want any grease to get in that threaded end of the head axle. Okay, bearings always go in with the pack side in, or the thrust bearing pack side in towards the head. Okay. And lastly, here's our outer race. And we'll fill that little groove in with some good quality bearing grease as well. Any excess off. So that's that one. I'm going to do the same for this one. Just put that spacer there. I'm just going to pull this out. Hopefully we can. This is where you might need get a rubber hammer. It's in there tight. I suspect they put no lube on. They didn't. Okay, so let's just take a peek at what kind of dampeners we got in here first. These are very stiff dampeners. But, makes sense, it's a fly-barred head. So, make sure those are in there. They actually don't use any teeter sleeve in there. It's just the dampeners that are keeping that head axle centered in the head. So again, I'm going to do the same thing with this one. I'm just going to push it out this way though. Because that didn't have any Loctite on it, however, I'm just going to show you a trick here. Again, don't lose that little spacer, a brass spacer that goes on the back. You can see all the thrust bearings are in there. There's no grease. There's that little spacer for the inner bearing, or between the thrust wash and that bearing. We'll throw that back in there right now. Anyways, because I'm not sure if that bolt had Loctite on it when they put it in. This one didn't, even though they were really tight. They tightened them down, but they didn't have Loctite in them. So you want to get that bolt out. How to do it? You know, it's in there tight. You're not going to break it free. So what I used to do is wrap a rag around this, a heavy rag or even electrical tape, and take a pair of vice grips to grab it. You don't want to be nicking the shaft. If you nick it, you basically shot, not only because it might tear these as you push them back through, you've got little stress risers in there, and this shaft is under enormous stress, and those stress risers could lead to cracking. But anyways, there is a tool for this. It's called a axle tool or whatever, and these are basically just tools with one-way bearings in them. So it will lock the shaft from turning one way. And so you just lock it in there and crack that loose. And again, there is no thread lock on there. So we'll just take all that off, and that's one little pile of goodness. Now, because I don't know how clean those ends are, and I really want to make sure there's absolutely no grease in there, I'm going to spray those out with brake clean. And if I had my air compressor here, I'd just give those a shot to let them dry, but that stuff will flash off pretty quick. By the time we're done with this bearing, packing it on everything, that'll be dry. So I'm going to end there. I just wanted you to see how I can get that bolt off. And if you don't have one of those axle tools, again, I've got these, I show these in both my setup and tips ebook and on my website in my tools section, how they work and where you can get them. Like I said, or you could wrap a rag around there or electrical tape enough to make sure when you get the vice grips on there to hold that thing from spinning, the vice grips aren't going to bite into the actual steel of the shaft. So we'll just we'll fast forward through the rest of this, and we'll come back when this is all put together. Okay, so we're back here. We're going to put this shaft back in, but we are going to put some lubrication on it. This not only helps it slide in and not get stuck in the dampeners, it keeps it from corroding. If you fly in, however, these, I think this actually might be a stainless shaft, so, no, it's not. That's a magnetic driver, at least it's become magnetic over the years, and, it's stuck to it, so it certainly isn't stainless. But whatever you do, don't get any grease in those threaded holes in the end, because, we've got those cleaned out. So it doesn't really matter which one you start with here. So get a brass washer on there. Actually, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna put a little more grease on here now. Just to make sure it's got just a thin layer on there. More for corrosion protection than anything. Brass spacer. Blade grip with all our bearings. Now this is another one that you do not want too much thread lock on, because it will seep into that thrust bearing. I like to see only about 4 to 5 threads with Loctite on them, and I try to watch very carefully if I can see any oozing out, and there's none. So we just snug that up. Now we do the same to the other side. Brass spacer. Fit on the blade grip. Okay. Get our little axle bolt. Again. Little bit of Loctite on the end. If you've got really greasy hands, you should clean them. You don't want any grease getting on here. And carefully thread it in. Okay, I'll just snug this down first with, let's just snug down. At this point, you just want to rotate these. Make sure there's no binding or anything. If there was binding, like if you felt something being notchy, if you felt it notchy, that means there's too much bearing preload or preload on the bearing, and there's too much pressure on that thrust bearing. If it's not bad, just leave it, because it'll tend, as the bird is running, you know, you've got a lot of centripetal force pulling those blades out. It's going to wear that bearing in a little bit. There's a little bit of break in. There shouldn't be much, though. If it's really notchy, though, what you're going to have to do, this rarely happens, especially on a good build or a good set of mechanics, these little brass spacer washers, you have to take them out, and if you've got a whetstone or even just a sanding block with some fine grit 600 sandpaper or something on it, you know, just rub them back and forth on the sandpaper just to take, you know, a thou or two off of the off of that spacer washer, just to eliminate some of that preload. But these are smooth as glass. This is a beautiful head. And final thing, let's just really torque it down. And for this, it's the easiest thing to use are two Allen keys, and you just twist them both in opposite directions to each other. And that really snugs it up. That's never coming in. Just take another feel, and oh boy, that is so smooth. So there's our head. That's all there is to it. Well, we've got the swash, or the head, we'll talk about the swash plate. I'm going to keep this button off just for setup purposes. I like using the T-bar for the T-Rex. You don't have to use that. You can eyeball these center just like that. You know, if you draw an imaginary line, hopefully the camera's picking this up, but if you draw an imaginary line from that bolt straight through, you know that arm is parallel to the shaft, and you know this blade grip is sitting at exactly 0 degrees. So when you're setting up your helicopter, when you put the blades in there, you zero out your pitch gauge when that arm is dead center along the imaginary line of that head axle. Same thing on the other side. So anyways, the head's done. I'm not going to put the head button back on for now. We'll just go over the swash plate. Only thing to go over here is to ensure all these balls are Loctite, have been Loctite. This one has been, but you never know. Looks like on these kits you can tell, because they use a red. It's not super strong red, though, like if you used Loctite red, which you'd probably never get out again. At least not on little things like this without heating them up. So just go around. Now, isn't that, see, the short balls have got a 2mm hex head in them. The little guys have got a 1.5. And that's likely because that's a bigger ball. I'm guessing 5mm, and the little guys are 4.75 in diameter. Well, let's measure that in case anyone's interested, because these are going to be transmitting the most force. Well, they're going up to the blade grip, so the linkage is bigger, and as is the ball. Yep, those are 5mm. Definitely. I bet you these are 4.75. No, 4.72. Yeah, so that would be considered a line 4.75. and the 5mm. I imagine all these ones are 4.75 as well. Yep. Shows 4.71, but... Anywho, and that was dumb, because I just forgot which one I left off at. That's the one I just did. back to this one. So all so far these have all been thread locked into place. So I'm probably not even necessary to do this, but again, better safe than sorry. All it would take is one misstep. That's why there's very few people I would trust to actually build a helicopter and fly it. It's a lot more reassuring when you do it yourself and you know exactly that everything has been done right. And there was no steps missed. And if something goes mechanically wrong, really, there's only one person to blame. Yeah, and so far every one of these balls have been locked in, but no big deal putting. Takes, what, 2 minutes to double check that? Okay, and the only other thing that's kind of unusual about this swash is it uses a metal, a steel ball on the inside. It's not a phenolic or a nylon. Not sure what I think about that. Longevity-wise, it should be fine, but you just got to make sure you do have adequate lubrication on that. So. You know, any good quality bearing grease again would work. I'm using the Align silicone stuff, but you just get it on there and work it around, and you'll feel how much how that smooths that ball right up in that socket. Okay, we're back. Basically at the home stretch of the build here. We've just got the tail boom to build, and then we're just going to mount it on the frame, and we're going to be pretty much done the mechanical part of the build. So for this part, basically all that's left in your box there should be your tail boom bag with the boom and the torque tube, push rod, and the tail boom braces. You've got your tail rotor servo mount bag. This is your horizontal mount for your horizontal fin. You've got your fin set. You've got your tail blades. You've got the pushrod guides. And of course the tail end drive assembly, the right angle drive assembly, the tail rotor. So the first thing I like doing here is putting the center bearing, getting that fixed onto the torque tube, because you've got to glue it, and this way it allows the glue to dry. Going by the Align manual again, the process here is you have to identify which is going to be the front and the rear of your torque tube. So we'll just put a little front, an F for front here. On the front, and what they want is they want this center bearing trimmed a little bit forward of the center point of the shaft. I think the theory there is if it's dead center, you can set up a harmonic oscillation in here. So if you've got it slightly off center, that's a lot less likely to occur. So we'll just get a tape measure. And we'll measure this up. It's roughly 70 millimeters. This doesn't have to be accurate down to the millimeter. So I guess 35 millimeters is our center point. Just double check that. So we'll mark this at 35. So that's our center point. Now, according to the instructions, they want the bearing trim to be 5 to 7 centimeters forward of that center point. So we'll 5 to 7, so we'll go 6. So right there. So that's where our bearing is going to be glued onto. You want it glued because you just don't want it freewheeling on there, because if it's freewheeling, it's eventually going to cut through the aluminum. Might not cut all the way through, but it will wear a groove in there, and you'll get a lot of bearing wobble. Now what I like to do at this point, seeing that CA glue does not glue, or does not hold well to anodized aluminum, I like to get just a little bit of sandpaper. This is 180 grit, you know, you could use 220. No, it doesn't, just something in that range. I'll just cut a little strip off, and I'll sand the anodizing. You know, you could use a rotary tool for this if you wanted to do it a little bit quicker. We'll do it over here so I'm not getting all the sanding on the assembly towel there. So I'll basically just sand the anodizing off. You know, really all you have to do is roughen it up. You know, and you might want to save this little piece of sandpaper for going over your frame. One of the suggestions that you'll see in all instructions is any sharp edges where you know there's going to be wires rubbing against is just to dull them down with some sandpaper to round them out so they're not as sharp. Myself, anytime I've got a wire going over an edge, I actually wrap it in either tape or in a sheath or put heat shrink over it. Because even when these are sanded down, eventually, you know, if through vibration, if a wire is rubbing on there, it is going to rub through. So I don't really bother with sanding all the sharp edges of the carbon frames, just because I always have mechanical protection around the wires, so they'll never wear through. So now that you've got that that done, we'll get out our brake clean again, make sure it's nice and clean. Okay. Now this is where you have to be really careful. I like thin CA for this because it will actually wick in. So what I will do is, and I don't put much on. What I actually like doing is putting the CA on a zip tie or a Q-tip or something like that, and then I'll just let it wick in there. Now you don't want gobs of it, because as you push this bearing on, you don't want the CA to wick into the bearing. And we'll just put it on there. And thin CA sets up super quick, but we'll just put this to the side for now and let that dry. So I'll just pause the camera here for a bit. Okay, so now we're back. So I've put the torque tube off to the side to let it dry. So the next thing we'll do now is we'll take the tail rotor drive assembly apart. Again, you want to make sure everything's got Loctite on it and whatnot. So for this, the one thing you'll notice, the tail rotor grips, or the tail blade grips, they don't have little inserts or little metal notches in there to hold the bolt, which a line does have. So you're gonna have to get a nut driver to hold those nuts when you're tightening and taking off the tail rotor blades. So we'll get another plate here for all our tail rotor components. And anytime I take bolts off of nuts off of bolts rather, I tend to screw them back on the bolt so I know which nut went with what. Yeah. So the first thing I'm going to check here, I won't pull those blades off yet. We'll check to see if these are Loctite, if there's any Loctite on these end plates. And I don't feel any. They're tight, but there's no Loctite on there. None whatsoever. So, and that's why you want to take, oh, there's a little bit there. That's why you do want to take a little extra time just to check if things have got Loctite on them. You know, it's kind of too bad. To me, they should just, if they're not going to do it right, don't do it at all. You know, maybe that might even save a little bit of money on the kits if, you know, if no one's going to the effort to actually put Loctite on. Again, why do it, why do a half-cocked job? Do it right or don't do it at all. You know, and personally, we probably people have been building helicopters for, you know, several years. We'll never trust a manufacturer that says they've Loctited everything, because I've not seen one helicopter that was perfect yet. The line doesn't matter. Okay, I guess we've got to take this off. So this is the little control arm, and it's nice that it is metal. So there's a little bit of Loctite on there, I felt it. So that would have been fine, but to get at those, you need to take that control arm off. Again, these sure don't feel like they've got Loctite. This one definitely doesn't. If it threads out really easy and there's no resistance, it's funny, this one does. I can feel there's resistance on there. So when I pull this out, you'll probably see some red Loctite on there. Yes, there is. So that's how you can tell. If something has Loctite on it or some kind of thread locking compound, once you loosen the bolt, if there's still resistance turning it, you know there's some type of locking compound on it. If it spins out super easy, you know it's got nothing on it. And again, these look nice and clean. If they look greasy or oily, you'd want to give them a shot of brake clean or something similar to ensure there's no assembly lube on them, or assembly oil, or machining oil sort. See, and that one came out super easy, and even though it looks like it does have a little bit of red Loctite on it, but or not red Loctite. If it was red Loctite, these things would be welded in there. It's whatever Phoenix Tech, the thread locking compound they use is red. It's certainly not red Loctite though. Okay, we'll check this little control arm mount. Okay, this one's definitely in there with Loctite. So is this one. So we wouldn't have had to take these out, but we've loosened them up. And once you loosen them, you have to reapply the thread locker. Again, you don't put much on. Just fill in the valleys of the threads. Wipe any excess off. Okay, so we've got those done. We've done all these. Let's check the ball that's in the slider block. Oh, it's definitely Loctite in place. So really, for the most part, most things have been thread locked, but certainly found a few that haven't been. And the one thing that I find comes loose, even sometimes when they're properly got thread locker on them, are these little Phillips screws. I almost lost a 600 Pro when one of these backed out, and I had definitely Loctited it. So these are something I check almost every flight. On my pre-flight, I check my tail rotor blade, these little linkage screws. Doesn't matter what type of helicopter it is. We may as well do those now. So this is where you're going to need a Phillips screwdriver. Well, that had Loctite on it. Now these are really critical that you don't put too much Loctite on, because they slide inside a little brass bushing. Okay, there's a little brass bushing in that link. And naturally, if you have Loctite and it gets in the bushing, it can seize the bushing. So just be careful with that when you're putting Loctite on here. Go really gentle on it. Make sure it's down deep in the valleys of the threads. You don't need it on the whole screw. If you think you put too much on, like I just know I did, you know, just roll it on a rag. Just the Loctite that's down in the valleys of the threads is going to be sufficient to lock it into place. And make sure when you tighten this down, really, the pivot is the brass inside the plastic. The brass is probably getting pinched, that little brass spacer or collar, or bushing if you wanted to call it a bushing, is probably getting pinched by the two arms of the linkage or forks of the linkage. But if you really snug it down and you notice this get tight, then you know there's some kind of, you've tightened these arm in or these forks in so much that they're pinching the linkage. But a good build won't allow that, because the little brass bushing in there is preventing those from pinching too tight against the linkage. And same thing here. So these little bushings are they're being held by the screw once they're pinched in, and the linkage is actually rotating on the outside of the brass. So the main thing is you don't have so much Loctite on here that it squishes out and then migrates and wicks in between the plastic and the little brass bushings. Really gobbed her on there thick then. Definitely too much. Actually, I didn't want to do that. I have to leave that off because we're taking those completely off the blade grips. Yeah, there's good Loctite in there, so I'm actually quite impressed with these kits. Seems where it's really needed, other than the rotor head. It wasn't in there, was it? So, but all in all, this tail probably would have been fine without going to all this trouble, but it's just something you want to do, and it doesn't hurt. Better safe than sorry. And as you can see, I'm just doing one at a time, because if you take it all apart, then you have to look at the instructions to see how it all goes back together. Whereas if you just do one little screw at a time, you'll know how it comes apart. It'll be interesting to see if we've got any Loctite in the actual blade. Oh, yes, we do. But I just want to check something out. I cannot remember if the 600 ESP has thrust bearings in the tail block. Yes, it does. So we have to take those out because I guarantee you they won't be. They won't be. They won't have grease in them. Well, I shouldn't guarantee that, but let's just say I'll be surprised if they do. And oh boy, they're tight. That's where an Allen key will come in handy. Oh, and I put lots of Loctite in there. And again, same with these thrust bearings in the tail. There's an inner and an outer on the race. So make sure you don't get those mixed up. And let's have a peek. Nope, not a speck of grease in there. Otherwise, yeah, we don't even have to take that off. Looks like there's a little spacer washer in there, so if that did come out when you took that out, there's a little spacer in there. Or is there? Nope, there isn't. Nope. So, we're back to the grease. I'm just going to fast forward through all this because you don't need to see me greasing these again. Same idea as when we did the tail, the main grips. These are just a lot smaller. So we'll just fast forward through all this. Okay, we're back here. I'm gonna check this. I don't know if you noticed, but when I had these off, I wanted to check what kind of hub this was, because the new 600 hubs, this is what they look like. They've got this slightly smaller end on them. It's machined down. These old style, they're the same thickness all the way out. So if you do have, and these are the ones that were used on the ESP. These won't work on the ESP. I got these hoping they would, but they won't fit. I'd have to update the entire tail block. So if you've got an old ESP, these Phoenix Tech tail hubs for their 600 ESP will fit. Will work, rather. So, all we've got left, oh yeah, I was going to check. Yeah, we want to make sure this, the actual tail hub is on the shaft. And, yeah, it had Loctite on it, but let's, seeing that we've got it out, we'll redo it. So, it's interesting that there's no tail grease at all. And actually, I should make sure that that is actually on a flat. Yes, it is. If you wanted to see, they actually don't have a flat. They've actually machined a little. Can I get this out? Come on, there you go. They've actually machined a little dimple right in there. So that's nice. So you just want to make sure that that set screw seats right in that dimple. So yeah, you don't have to worry about, you know, setting that in or out. Ideally, you want the end of that shaft flush with the end of the hub. But with that little dimple in there, there's only itself positions it, so you don't have to worry about that. So all that's left here is the sits like this on the helicopter, so the control arm is on the bottom this way. What I would like to do now is put a little grease on this ball. If this was a plastic, a plastic control arm, I wouldn't bother with this step, because the plastic would be somewhat self-lubricating on the ball, whereas the metal certainly is not. Again, here is a critical spot where you cannot put too much thread locker, because it will wick into the bearing in the control rod. So make sure you go gingerly on the thread lock in there. And I'll just get that lined up. Put her down. Tighten this up. Make sure it's still nice and smooth, which it is. And at this point you can put some lube, if you want, grease on the actual shaft. On the tail rotor shaft here. For that pitch slider. And you'll notice it just gets butter smooth then. And that's exactly what you want. And that's a good maintenance one to keep an eye on. You don't need much on there, but you want enough to have a layer of grease between the slider and the shaft. So that's the trail drive finished with. I'm just going to pause it while we get some other stuff out, and we'll continue on with the tail build. Okay, continuing on from our tail rotor. Here's our torque tube that we had glued the support bearing on earlier with, and it's dry now. I should mention, I just did check these little button head screws to make sure they were Loctited in there, and they are. So it's something that you probably wouldn't have to check, but if you wanted to, of course, it's better safe than sorry. As I mentioned in the unboxing, this is kind of a little added bonus feature on this torque tube. May as well put on the bearing support, and that's in the bag with the push rod supports as well. Here's your push rod ball links, so don't lose those. You could thread them on. Well, no, you don't want to thread them on the push rod yet, because you've got to slide that in afterwards. But you could certainly do that. Anyways, so here's the rubber bearing support, and there's a little groove inside. Anyone who's built these before will be very familiar with these, and you just slide that over that bearing and make sure it's on there. This is also a really good time, even before you do that, just roll that bearing to make sure none of the CA glue got inside of it. But as long as you go really thin with the CA and you're careful when you slide that on, you won't have a problem with that. So now we're going to slide this into the boom. This is the front section of the boom, where there's this kind of keyway cut out, and the back section's just got the single hole. Remember, there is a front and a back to this, because we've got these bearing slightly forward. To aid in pushing this in, the Align kits actually came with a clear plastic tube that you could jam it in with. It would push this down the tube. I never really found they were necessary. What I like to do is get a little silicone lube. Okay, you lube up the outside of this rubber. You don't have to go thick, and anything you've got left on your finger, just kind of get in the boom. But this is where some silicone grease, really, or spray, comes into effect. I just give a liberal coating of spray down there. And now we'll just slide this in and it will go in really, really slick. You kind of have to wiggle it in there a little bit. Well, at least it should go slick. I really doesn't, okay, yeah, once you get it started, it might be easier to actually start at the other end, but, and then, you know, just work it in. And you want it, so there's roughly the same amount of torque tube coming out of each end. This will self-center. Okay, so just wipe off any silicone that you got on the tube here. So the torque tube's in place. Kind of up to you at this point if you want to mount it on the mechanics or not. Let's do that. So just slide it. Hopefully we'll slide it in. And there's a little notch in there to catch it, that catches that key weight. And it's a little tight. Okay. We will, at this point, we will slide, actually before we slide those on, let's slide our servo arms on. You can actually pry these apart and snap them over, but while we're thinking of it, why don't we just snap them on now? Are these ones actually metal? If they are, okay, no, they have to slide on. These are metal. That's nice. Pretty sure we orient, yeah. So we orient them this way. So we'll just slide those on now. We won't tighten them or anything. In fact, we won't even tighten them until we... I'm not even going to bother putting the servo plate on until we do have the electronics. I don't have the electronics yet for this, so they're just going to stay on there. We'll slide one plastic support. By the way, on these things, in the instructions, they say to anchor them with a, where'd that thing go? With a zip tie, you just fire a zip tie under there and, you know, chop it off. So it's, and that keeps it on, but to be honest, these metal ones, I got these from Hobby King, they work really well. If you're in pod and boom, not a big deal. But if it's going in a scale fuse, these can move around on you when you're sliding it in and out of the fuselage, even if they're held. One thing you can do is you can actually tape them. That's what I was originally doing when I was doing my first couple of scale builds with the 600 ESP. I'd actually tape these. But they could still move or rip if they caught on something. But I like using these metal ones. And again, you can get these at Hobby King. They're super cheap. And once you snug that down, they're not going anywhere. And these are really nice for holding the donut. On one build that I had a problem with the donut sliding around, I actually just took these, I cut the arm off, and I'm just using it as a donut clamp. I've got one on each end of the donut, and then the donut won't move, but you don't need to know about that. But anyways, there's several ways to anchor those. Now I'll throw our... Okay, we've got it. We'll put our tail rotor on. Take out those. And this little block does have to come out because there's a little centering peg in there that goes through there, and that's what lines it up with that hole. And you just turn this until it's... And we've got to push... Oh yeah, there we go. And when you're sliding that on, you might have to just turn the gears so you line those splines up. And you'll see the holes in there, so you know the boom is all the way forward. It's a little, it's tail heavy right now because we don't have, obviously, motor mount or the motor in there or anything. The motor gives it quite a bit of front mass, and obviously no battery pack. So why don't we put the tail fin on right now so it's not always dragging on the ground. Actually, we should put on, I forgot to put on the other push rod stay. We'll get our little plastic block here. See, that holds it in. Get this tail fin on. Just fire one of these through right now. Actually, we'll fire both through. See how good everything lines up. And this has been a fun build. I've always enjoyed building T-Rex 600s though, so that really comes as no surprise, but now I should have Loctited that, but for now I just want to see what the alignment looks like. Oh geez, that's nice. So yeah, that's great actually. So let's give this a shot of. Thread lock. And you just need it right on the very end because all you're threading into is this back half of the mount. And as you tighten these, you're actually crimping that tail block onto the boom, but there's also that little plastic locating button in there that's also locking it into place. Alignment again. Very nice. So all that's left is the plastic tail blades. I'm not going to put them on right now, just because I've got to mount the electronics and everything, and I just don't want the tail blades getting in the way. We can certainly put the braces on. I'm not going to put the push rod in yet until I do have my tail servo. Seems pointless to do that at this point. If you recall, in our little parts bin here, spare parts, we had those two long screws for the brace rods. So we will, what size are these? Oh, they are 2.5s. Okay, I've got that washer kind of crooked in there. Let's just make sure we're, yep. There's no back or front on these, so you don't have to worry about that. Now again, in the instructions, they show to build the whole boom and everything before you slide it in, but I kind of like doing it this way. I just snugged that up a little bit, so it's holding that brace in place. Let's turn this around. Problem is there, it's just a little off. It's easier to do it when you're looking straight on. Okay, the other thing left is this little the last bag we're opening up. Yeah, there's a few little bags left over. I'm going to go over those right at the end here. But for the most part. So you've got two little short screws. That's what threads into the little clamp or whatever. This will go on top. Then use the longer screws for the fin, wherever that is. It's probably underneath the assembly towel here. Oh no, there it is. Another bag to throw out. Feels good throwing all these bags out. Means we're almost done. So we didn't have to put Loctite on those, of course, because they're in plastic. These ones we do. Put one of those beauty washers on. Turn around. Keep a somewhat organized work area. And I'll tighten these right up until I get that fin on. Fin, two more beauty washers over the longer M3 by, looks like, 14. And all these dimensions are in the T-Rex manual. And this thing has been... building this is pretty much following that manual to the letter. It's working out really well. Certainly one of the nicer clones out there, I would say. Right now it's pretty much the only clone out there for 600 ESP. Oh, and we forgot something, which I'm sure everyone was already noticing. Our little upper plate here. Why don't we put that on first? Might make life a little easier. So when you tighten these down, again, you just eyeball down the boom. You make sure you make sure that thing's going on level. If you notice a bigger air gap or a gap between the plate there and as you're tightening this down, you can slightly shift it. But again, I'm just eyeballing it level with the top of the helicopter there. You snug them down a bit of a time at a time. Make sure it's going on level. If you snug one down, it'll cockeye it off one way or the other. You tighten one all the way up before you do the other, so it's best just to do a bit at a time until they're right snug, which they are now. Now we can tighten these finally. Tighten these. Didn't do that one, did I? And that is pretty much it. We'll throw the swash plate on. And put the head on here. Just to take a peek at what it looks like. I haven't done anything with the canopy. That will be, well, that doesn't need any instruction. This head's gonna have to come off when you're setting up your swash plate so you can level it and whatnot. Come on, get in there. There you go. These go on the longer balls, but I'm not gonna clamp them on yet because I'll be taking the head off and I wanna balance the blades again with the head. So that's basically the build. Let's just see what we've got left here. We've got that front plate, which goes up in here, as everyone's probably familiar with. And that's what your battery, you've got your Velcro on there, battery straps on, bottom of the battery sits there. We've still got that elevator box for the elevator servo. Not doing anything with that yet though, of course, until I get my electronics. Got the pinion and the screws to hold the motor on. We've got all these little button screws, these four that are remaining, are for that front plate. I can't remember what these four are for. So anytime, oh yeah, of course we've missed some pretty important part here. These, we haven't clamped our boom on. Just take there's little recesses in the back here that accommodate the lock nuts. Okay. Again, that's just like on the 600 or in the ESP. Well, pretty much all of the line 600s. And, so we've got a couple of these little buttons left over. I'm not too sure what they would be for. Might be for this. I don't know. All the servo mounts are here. So, but you just want to go over if there's a couple of parts left over. Just make sure they're not for anything that you missed. We've still got all our push rods set here that we've got to measure up. But until I have the servos in, I'm not going to worry about that. Again, this is just the mechanical part of the build. Those are the tail rotor blade holder bolts. These are the linkages for the tail rotor push rod. We've got our two main push rods for the head to the swash plate. And of course, we've got the head button. There was this other bag that we took out of the parts bag that had the blade holder and everything in it. These are all spares, obviously. So that's kind of nice for a clone to give you some spare hardware. You know, it's basically a bolt of every sort in there. Some ball links. So it's actually a nice little hardware bag. So that's pretty much the build. The only other thing that's in here that may be of interest, I went over that in the unboxing. You know, there's zip ties and tie straps in there and whatnot for your battery or all your wiring management. But there's also the servo wheels with all the balls on, with all the balls. So comes with all the goodies. Anyways, I hope you enjoyed this build.